to live without knowing. I did one time not anything in any sense whatever until I didn't know it. But what is the good of beginning any kind of work when one doesn't know whether one will have time to finish it or not? Very well, said G, to know the future is the first aim. Who else can formulate his aim? I should like to be convinced that I shall go on existing after the death of the physical body, or, if this depends upon me, I should like to work in order to exist after death, said one of the company. I don't care whether I know the future or not, or whether I am certain or not certain of life after death, said another, if I remain what I am now. What I feel most strongly is that I am not master of myself, and if I were to formulate my aim, I should say that I want to be master of myself. I should like to understand the teaching of Christ, and to be a Christian in the true sense of the term, said the next. I should like to be able to help people, said another. I should like to know how to stop wars, said another. Well, that's enough, said G. We have now sufficient material to go on with. The best formulation of those that have been put forward is the wish to be one's own master. Without this nothing else is possible and without this nothing else will have any value. But let us begin with the first question, or the first aim. In order to know the future, it is necessary first to know the present in all its details, as well as to know the past. Today is what it is because yesterday was what it was. And if today is like yesterday, tomorrow will be like today. If you want tomorrow to be different, you must make today different. If today is simply a consequence of yesterday, tomorrow will be a consequence of today in exactly the same way. And if one has studied thoroughly what happened yesterday, the day before yesterday, a week ago, a year, 10 years ago, one can say unmistakably what will and what will not happen tomorrow. But at present we have not sufficient material at our disposal to discuss this question seriously. What happens or may happen to us may depend upon three causes, upon accident, upon fate, or upon our own will. Such as we are almost wholly dependent upon accident. We can have no fate in the real sense of the word any more than we can have will. If we had will, then for this alone we should know the future, because we should then make our future, and make it such as we want it to be. If we had fate, we could also know the future, because fate corresponds to type. If the type is known, then its fate can be known, that is, both the past and the future. But accidents cannot be foreseen. Today a man is one, tomorrow he is different, today one thing happens to him, tomorrow another. But are you not able to foresee what is going to happen to each of us? Somebody asked, that is to say, foretell what result each of us will reach in work on himself and whether it is worth his while to begin work. It is impossible to say, said G. One can only foretell the future for men. It is impossible to foretell the future for man-machines. Their direction changes every moment. At one moment a machine of this kind is going in one direction and you can calculate where it can get to, but 5 minutes later it is already going in quite a different direction and all your calculations prove to be wrong. Therefore, before talking about knowing the future, one must know whose future is meant. If a man wants to know his own future, he must first of all know himself. Then he will see whether it is worth his while to know the future. Sometimes, maybe, it is better not to know it. It sounds paradoxical that we have every right to say that we know our future. It will be exactly the same as our past has been. Nothing can change it itself. And in practice, in order to study the future, one must learn to notice and to remember the moments when we really know the future and when we act in accordance with this knowledge. Then judging by results, it will be possible to demonstrate that we really do know the future. This happens in a simple way in business. For instance, every good commercial businessman knows the future. If he does not know the future, his business will smash. In work on oneself, one must be a good businessman, a good merchant. And knowing the future is worthwhile only when a man can be his own master. There was a question here about the future life, about how to create it, how to avoid final death, how not to die. For this it is necessary, to me, if a man is changing every minute, if there is nothing in him that can withstand external influences, it means that there is nothing in him that can withstand death. But if he becomes independent of external influences, if there appears in him something that can live by itself, this something may not die. In ordinary circumstances, we die every moment. External influences change and we change with them. That is, many of our eyes die. If a man develops in himself a permanent eye that can survive a change in external conditions, it can survive the death of the physical body. The whole secret is that one cannot work for a future life without working for this one. In working for life, a man works for death, or rather, for immortality. Therefore, work for more. Mortality, if one may so call it, cannot be separated from general work. In attaining the one, a man attains the other. A man may strive to be simply for the sake of his own life's interests. Through this alone, he may become immortal. We do not speak specially of a future life and we do not study whether it exists or not, because the laws are everywhere the same. In studying his own life as he knows it, and the lives of other men, from birth to death, a man is studying all the laws which govern life and death and immortality. If he becomes the master of his life, he may become the master of his death. Another question is how to become a Christian. First of all, it is necessary to understand that a Christian is not a man who calls himself a Christian or whom others call a Christian. A Christian is one who lives in accordance with Christ's precepts. Such as we cannot be Christians. In order to be Christian, we must be able to do what we cannot do, witness everything, happens. Christ says, love your enemies, but how can we love our enemies when we cannot even love our friends? Sometimes, it loves, and sometimes, it does not love. Such as here we cannot even really desire to be Christian because, again, sometimes, it desires, and sometimes, it does not desire. And one and the same thing cannot be desired for long, because suddenly, instead of desiring to be a Christian, a man remembers a very good, very expensive carpet that he has seen in a shop, and instead of wishing to be a